This meeting is being recorded. It is the NFL Spread Pod. We'll talk about other things besides for the NFL. Title is here, but the lead story, I was told by JSU and Big T after we went off the air that you were really sweating something very, 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 very hard, and you had no reason to because it was way too early. So please share your failure with us.
I mean, I still 7x'd that day. So I'm not salty. I was just thinking I would more like 17x. I really thought I'd hit the five-figure mark easily. I was at $5,000 near the end of the third quarter. Davante Adams just needs 7 fantasy points. If Davante Adams gets me, like, you know, he was pacing like 28. If he just got 21 or 22, I think I would have been in 5 figures easily. And instead he gets, I think, two or three fantasy points in the second half. I'm tilted. It's like I've been on a heater for the last 2 weeks. Like, I'm feeling good. And then this heater has come to a screeching halt in a way. I played a DNP guy in soccer yesterday, and it cost me second place. I just needed 3 points from the guy. I tried to make a global swap change at 244. It didn't get in, and find out it cost me $1,300. I think I netted $200 on the entry. So this heater has been bad. The showdown, I cost myself by accidentally duping a line and not captaining Russell Westbrook one night. Cost me about $6,000. I'm just running so bad while I'm running so good. I'm due for a six-figure hit. There's only one way God can really make this right, and that's by shipping tonight in basketball. And DJ Augustine's not starting, so we're off to a great start.
You're mush. Sounds awful. But you also didn't have that money. You know that, right, Rubio? Like, that money was never—
I'm not saying I lost it. I'm just saying I was really looking forward to it.
Yeah, it's like playing.
I have had worse swings, but I'm still get salty when I have.
You know what? This reminds me of playing like the Monday through Thursday slate in the NFL, and then you started everybody except for like two positions, and you were in like fifth place, but then you ended up not nearly as high because
I'm the guy who's sitting there at 4x on his NBA night with the late game to go and thinking I'm not going to cash. Like, I'm not much of an optimist when it comes to fucking fantasy sports. Okay. But that. At that time, Davante Adams, what, he was 5 for 66 at half and ends with 7 for 78. I'm going to be salty. I am.
Are you a tilter? I feel like you're tilting.
I'm tilting after the fact. But, yes, I am very much – I'm very calm unless I just feel like I get fucked. Like, Kevin Hoyter got injured the other night, cost me some nice giblets. And, you know, I wasn't salty because injuries happen. But when a guy just sucks – and a guy I was so high on too, I called him a lock and everything – that's when it hurts the most. My pride.
Rubio's a tilter, Holden.
I didn't know that about him. That's concerning.
I broke my phone once by tilting. I threw it on the ground after a Champions League goal. So this is soccer a few years ago. I spiked my phone on the living room carpet, and I picked it up, and it was shattered. And I ended up cashing that slate. That's what makes it even worse. But, yeah, it was a nice little phone repair bill.
Did you make enough money to pay for the new phone and your broken thumb?
That day, yeah.
Oh, that's good.
That was back when Neymar was on Barcelona and shit.
You're talking soccer, so I don't
understand. Nothing to you. I just realized that.
Title, have you ever heard of this soccer thing? Have you tried playing?
I play. Doesn't everyone play as a kid? Like, of course I played.
No, DFS.
Oh, no. I played it once. I know the guys asked Jamie, Crushes, Ruby. Like, we have a really good soccer team. It's just if I never watch, I'd play enough sports and stuff where I don't want to overdo it. But, no, our soccer team crushes.
I threw in a live bet one time for title, and I think the live bet lost.
Oh, yeah. So I tailed Rubio once. I lost. But that's all right.
Yeah,
I did that a couple times with his lineups in DFS.
Well, the over was on fire, but the Poland did not cover.
Or Rubio. Anything else you'd like to add about Rubio's story title, or can we get to you for a minute?
We can get to my disappointment.
Okay. Well, I'll just say this. My stack last week was Rodgers and Adams and MVS, and it was not good. It was miserable. But there was a worse stack, Titletown. Which one was that?
The one I reminded you about pre-show to even talk about this conversation. I was disappointed in myself, but I was not disappointed in my stack. I just completely, when you get stuff wrong, you get stuff wrong and you just take last. If you take one place out of min cash, you still lost. So I was in last place pretty much. My other guys actually did good. So Russell Wilson, DK Metcalf, Tyler Lockett. I guess this Green Bay defense might actually be legit. And, of course, this is the one week that Justin Jefferson's playing them, so I don't know what to do because I was watching that game, what they've done to Kyler Mahomes and Russell Wilson. Like, this might be the best defense Aaron Rodgers ever had, but it might be still a little too early. However, I was disappointed at myself because I hopped on the Morningwood show, talked about the stack, whatever. I was completely wrong. I'm not mad about that. However, I came in with an SO play expected in the back of my head as Justin Jefferson because that's just my guy and I play him every week and I loved him and I had a ton. But last second, I changed it because I was hyping up the stack so much to DK Metcalf. And, yeah, we know how many points that difference was.
Well, that's just terrific. Do you want to come back on? You want to come back on the show?
I don't after that performance, I'm not sure I was already not supposed – I mean, I hopped on because, of course, anyway, whatever. But someone, a special guest, was supposed to hop on, and I guess you guys got stiff. So someone had to come on and
– No one had to come on.
Unfortunately, give out a loser.
Thank you. I appreciate you hopping on. No one has to save Hoop and Big T, okay?
I had to hop on, actually, because you forgot who my stack was.
Oh, yeah, that too.
I wish we left that we both forgot about it.
Do you know the hoops that – Rubio would have to hop through to get on that show? Do you have any idea how difficult it would be? He would basically have to beg Big T.
I don't think so.
Beg him, Rubio, to get on that show. Why don't you try getting on the show Sunday then? That would be wonderful.
I don't think I'll try. And that's an early wake up call, isn't it? Like 9 or 10. What time does the show start?
Yeah, like 10:30.
You know, I did watch you at work, Holden. It was nice. I thought it was pretty nice. I think I'm just a text away. But I could see totally being ghosted by Big T, though. Like, that's no problem. I was watching the end of the NBA show. He does hang up on people. Like,
yeah, he does. No, I was in chat saying that, too. JSU nailed it.
Yeah, he's bad about that. He said, oh, it's my thing. It's my thing. Well, what's your thing? Being an asshole?
Like, that's his thing. That makes it so much better.
You just hang up. You're done. What's there to talk about? Like, what the fuck? Not even, like, I would say goodbye. It's nice. Say goodbye just once.
I will say this. Listen, I was like this with Tony. This was back on Monday or Tuesday. I did an inside DFS studio with Ali. So he's called me more in the last week than he ever has. Now, then again, I accidentally had his number blocked for like 6 months, but that was an accident. So anyways, oh my God, man. Big T right now with the hanging up, I'm sitting there and he says goodbye. And I just looked at my phone like he didn't even say goodbye, I should say. And yeah. I just looked at my phone like, did that really just happen? So and then I hear everybody else had the same exact issue with Tony. So it's not as big a deal because everyone does it. It wasn't just, you know, one or two people, but yeah, it's rough.
Now that I know he says that's my thing, that makes it so much funnier. And now every time I'm just gonna beat him to the hang up.
Just hang up.
There you go. Oh,
now that I know that's his thing and he self-proclaimed it, I'm definitely and the best thing is
he self-proclaimed your strategy. Now he's gonna have it up.
He doesn't listen to the show. I'm calling you up, Big T. And I don't know for sure. Well, if he took like a week to watch the Rubio chip challenge,
yeah.
I don't know. I could be wrong. Big T, let me hear about it. If you guys tell him that's bogus.
Uncle T watches.
He listens.
Right.
Uncle T's the man.
Uncle T probably goes to Big T.
No.
And says, well, I don't know about this because we got a rat in the midst right now. His name is Rubio Dimes.
I was wondering what I literally don't recall. What's
You've
up?
Been, you ratted me out to Uncle T.
What did I say?
I don't know. You during the show, you texted him something about edibles. It was awful. And Uncle T was very, very easy to give your name up too.
Hey, I didn't say it was awful.
Someone Rubio.
I put here. Hold up. Here
he said. Hold on. You admitted we were on the Morningwood show that you.
You
told the people
I eat edibles.
Hey, no, Uncle T said he wanted to clear the record. He said, you know, he wanted to clear that he didn't call me immature, and you did last week. And I put, oh, my, you know, he was high as a kite. I don't think I didn't care for a word he said.
Right.
Yeah, so that's all I said.
Then Uncle T, you know, Uncle T brings it up. It's very uncomfortable on the old guy's show. It derails the old
guy. Gummy focus. In right now.
Then, huh?
You're clearly a gummy in right now.
I'm not.
Do you dye your hair, by the way? Joey Work said something. I feel like you do.
Did he? I have not dyed my hair for about 8 months. All the natural color is back. I am putting the gray on the side.
That's what I was noticing quite a bit. It looks nice.
Like Still, but that gray, man, it doesn't. I don't think it pops up that well on the camera.
Dude, that just for men
side and the top is coming in. Yeah. So just no, I don't dye my hair. I did it for about a year because I was into dating women in their 20s and it helped. No longer do I care about that. So awkward. Anything else we needed to get into? NBA. I wanted to talk some NBA with you guys before. How's the NBA going for you guys this season? Title, how's the NBA going? Yeah, everybody's good.
Good. That's my best.
How's it going?
That's my most profit. Very good.
Fuck yourself up.
Play on Yahoo. I mean, I grind cash games.
Sell subscriptions.
I grind cash games. You'll see me in the lobby. I now play Yahoo full time too. So I got the three sports that I get as much volume as I can in cash games. So I let the tournament people. I do some tournaments once in a while, but mainly just in the cash streets. But it's been going very good. NBA is my most profitable.
I think that it is the best sport of all of our analysts combined.
Yeah, I'll say
the NBA is. You know, the NFL.
There's the least amount of variance too, though. Like baseball, you need home touchdown. Yeah, for sure. But like football, you need touchdown variance. Like basketball, it's easy to predict minutes, usage. This guy's out. This person, like, so it's the most predictable in my opinion, which is why day to day, I think it's the best. But you're right. I agree.
Rubio, how's it going for you?
I got real nice on the Sixers night, and then I came. I'm actually doing really good in the showdown. It's actually kind of fun. I need to pick my slates a little more wisely. I'm not going to be playing heavy on Clipper slates, but these Lakers slates have been an absolute gold mine late. Like, you literally just jammed the top two guys, and the cheap guys are 1K, and no one else is doing that for some reason. So, I mean, I've been having a great time. The Sixers night about a week ago, like Tuesday or something like that, I got lucky. I stacked seven guys from that game and then went to the Louisville game and came back to Giblets after watching Norm Powell. So it was kind of fun.
What about you, Holden? Are you playing? You're doing the up to lock almost every day, so it's hard to do a lot of lineups. But are you throwing a lineup in once in a while?
NBA?
Yeah.
Any day I do a show, I throw a lineup in. Actually, I do a lineup every day but Sunday.
Nice.
Every day. Yeah, so I play NBA every day now. I got to get better at it. You know what I'm saying? Like it's so big at the site. Just for me and coming through Roto Grinders and stuff like that, it's like NBA is big, but it's the NFL, man. And really it's DFS. It is the NFL. I don't get, you know, your favorite sport might be NBA, but the big money one,
oh, for sure,
it's the NFL. And it's the one that gets people into DFS more than anything.
For sure. It was the sport that got me in, like when I was played a little below 18, but like, yeah, the football season, football runs it all for sure. But the problem, it's not a problem, but
I put one lineup in 6 days a week. I do the NFL every single slate. I'm really into showdown this year, Rubio. I've been doing a lot of showdown, different various success. You know, some weeks I'll hit, some weeks it doesn't. I think probably on the season, I'm probably actually up a little bit because I hit, you know, a top 10, which was
the Sunday nights.
Great.
The Sunday night, like the primetime games, or just like, kind
of not
like,
only, yeah, any of them really, even like the Broncos Eagles game. I've been playing like this now. I'm just so, I have to dig into the Denver team so much.
Yeah, I saw your
and I'm like, fuck it. I'll just like, I know Melvin Gordon's going to get a fucking touchdown this week. Let's put him in there. So that's interesting too. And we do have the showdown content. What do we have right now, Rubio, for showdown content, NBA, NFL, because the code is RPS Heater 25% off your first payment of a monthly plan. And this is just some of the stuff on the showdown site. You get everything. You get the showdown site, you get the sports site, and then for what is an extra $20, you get the betting site, get bets. You can just get that without the other discount. All right, so what do we got here on showdowns?
Well, on showdown, it's the nightly affair, you know. NBA, it's every night. And then I do the NFL stuff on Thursday, Sunday, and Monday, kind of chilling up with a playbook. And you have Big T, Tambo, and like JSU and them providing their cores and player pools. And it's just real nice. I mean, you know, you'll still have some people asking, where's the content? Where's the content? It's on the showdown site. AP does his article every primetime game as well for the NFL. So, I mean, there's a ton of content out there for showdowns.
Okay. Terrific, boys. We're ready to talk a little NFL. Let's go look at the slate that is coming up. And I'll ask you guys about a game first. Cowboys, Chiefs. What are we doing here? So I'll ask you this, Title. Do you believe that the Chiefs' offensive slump is over? Or do you look at it like, hey, the Raiders decided to play cover three instead of doing what everybody else did, which is drop the safeties? Where are you on the Chiefs' offense right now?
Yeah, I've always been a huge believer in Patrick Mahomes, Tyreek. Now Kelce looks back to healthy. I'm going to go on to the game plan of they're back. They're putting up points. Trust Vegas on this one. So, loved Kelce, loved Tyreek, loved Mahomes, loved Darrell Williams. Like, I think they're back.
How about you, Rubio? What do you think about the Cowboys, too?
Yeah, like, I think the Chiefs' defense, surprisingly, has gotten a little bit better, too. And I think we were kind of hating on them. But
couldn't get worse.
The Chiefs, they're you kind of mentioned it with the Packers having a better defense late, right? And I thought originally, like, oh, man, that game against the Packers is one of the worst games the Chiefs have had. And then they go out there and beat the Raiders kind of soundly. I think that speaks merit to the Packers' defense a little bit more, as well as, you know, the Chiefs' defense has shored up some things. You know, they kind of shut down the Giants. They kind of shut down the Packers, and now the Raiders. I understand there's subpar quarterbacks. Now they get an actual team in front of them. But I'm kind of with you. I trust Vegas here. But I'm kind of starting to come around to the Chiefs a little bit. But Dak Prescott and CeeDee Lamb looked so good last week. It's tough to ignore them, that's for sure.
No doubt about it. All right, Title, let's get into this here, the quarterback position this week. I know you take more of a cash stance, and Rubio, obviously, you and me talk a little tournaments here, but who's the play right now? Is it Lamar at 8K? Want to go up to Josh Allen? Dak Prescott's a lot cheaper at 7-2. So give me the quarterback rundown.
So I've paid up pretty much all year. Josh Allen and Lamar are the two I pretty much play every week. I like Josh Allen at 8-1. I like Lamar as well. So I think Lamar's at 8K. I think it's one of those two if you're going up. Wouldn't mind if you just couldn't get you needed like a couple $100 to save. Patrick Mahomes is 7-6. So those three, if you're spending up, prefer Lamar and Allen. But Cam Newton's in consideration this week at 5.1K. We know his rushing upside, his goal line equity is huge. 5.1K, if we're not getting value throughout the week, like we had Dearness Johnson last week, we had Mark Ingram. If the value's not there, I could see myself going for a Cam Newton to get me like a Tyreek Hill, a Devontae, pay up at running back and stuff. So I think you go all the way up or you go all the way down.
Rubio, I'm going to bring up a player to you, okay, for GPP. Say what you want. Justin Fields, 5-7 on DK. Looks like he found things out against Pittsburgh in the second half. So he's got a game where he had 26 DK points, 19 in his last start. He's only 5'7". Can I interest you in any Justin Fields?
Yeah, I can be fancied a little bit just because I think you have more potential running naked than the other quarterbacks. But, you know, as much as he figured out against Pittsburgh there in the second half and that touchdown that he threw to Jimmy Graham pissed me off entirely after it was ruled off after – some bullshit, you know, calls. And I felt like I was on the wrong end of every call that game. But he's looked more confident. He looks like he's not afraid to run the ball. And I think the offense is actually, like, finally letting him be himself. And that's really good to see. He's definitely not first on my radar, but I totally don't hate the call. And I think for the quarterback spot, it's definitely in play. Because I think if you get a quarterback who can make plays on the ground, it's better than most. And just kind of, like, circling back to it, you know, I kind of want guys who are going to make plays on the ground this week. Like Lamar Jackson, even at 8K in that same game, like he's just shown such an ability to just amass, you know, 100 yards on the ground, even or getting it done through the air. Cam Newton, 5.1, like Title said, now that the Washington Football Team is without Chase Young, that can only benefit him, you know, in his start here with Christian McCaffrey back there too. I think that offense finally starts to click again. But yeah, I could be fancied by any of those trio guys who can just get it done on the ground.
Cam Newton plays a full game against the Washington Football Team with no Chase Young. We already saw him try and put the ball. He ran three times in the red zone, I think. He was right there at the goal line. Just, you know, it was two red zone attempts. He took him away from McCaffrey. Very unfortunate there. either one of you. 5-1 on DraftKings, 7-5 on FanDuel. Cam Newton in a GPP deep sleeper, yes or no?
My question is yes or no. Do you listen to what Title said? Yes or no?
No.
Yep. I all the way up to Allen, Lamar, Mahomes, or all the way down to Cam Newton. Cam is very much in play, depending on the value we get.
I truly love him.
I am wondering what you were doing though when.
Yeah, I'm trying to think that too.
But that's all right. We can
move circled on. Around Cam.
I wrote the word terrific for something, and then I terrific, never got back to it.
Terrific, yeah. Cam Newton though. Yes, terrific. He's very very much in play. I like him. Okay. Cast consideration for sure.
All right, focus. Now I have not zoned out for 2 minutes, which is an improvement. I just want to let you guys know this. Christian McCaffrey is 8-9 on DK, and it seems as though Cam is going to take the goal line work away from him sometimes, but he's getting so much volume in the passing game, and he's back. Like, he looked great. He's getting the touches. He's had 23 last week. Rubio, Christian McCaffrey this week against Washington. Thoughts?
I'm a huge fan of Caff. Like, I think it kind of goes back to the beginning of the season. If he's healthy, if he's a full go, he's always going to be on my list. And I'm not concerned about Cam Newton stealing away touchdowns from him. Sam Darnold stole a lot of touchdowns from him at the beginning of the year. And McCaffrey, you could say he ran bad on touchdowns for the most part. But I think that's just due to come over the course of time. Like, he's still one of the best running backs there is. He's still going to get his touches. And I still think the Panthers make it a point to make him happy. And I understand that Cam kind of stole a couple of the goal line looks, but it's Christian McCaffrey. I mean, Chuba Hubbard scored last week, if I believe. So I think McCaffrey could easily get one of those touches, and that floor is just miles high. And I think it's just so much better than everyone else in this range that, you know, you'd be a fool not to consider him just because of those goal line touches.
So would you take him over Taylor at Buffalo, Cook versus Green Bay this week?
Yeah, 100%. Okay. That being said, I've come around on Taylor. Title got it right, and I'll keep saying that over and over again. Taylor is RB. And now that Caffrey's back, I originally thought Taylor would be RB1 for the rest of the season, but I think he's RB2 from here on out.
Yep, I'm with you. Title, Christian McCaffrey, and then maybe just talk about some of the top-tier guys like Taylor and like Dalvin Cook.
Cam's letting people know he's back, but Christian McCaffrey is definitely back. He makes the team and offense so much better. He ran bad at the goal line too. Like, yes, Cam's going to take stuff away. McCaffrey's still going to get his chances. I think he falls in the box. 8,900 is silly. Like, we'd be paying 10K for McCaffrey at this point. He looked healthy. He did go to the 10. So that's always going to be a concern, but I'm probably going to be 100% in tournaments. I think the price is dumb. Dalvin, like, of course, I'm definitely going to go McCaffrey over Dalvin, especially that I'm believing in this Green Bay defense. Not going to play Dalvin there. You can always play Jonathan Taylor. He's another one of the boys. But I'm McCaffrey over Jonathan Taylor at this point. I think McCaffrey's definitely back to what he does. So McCaffrey in the upper tier. Mid-tier is pretty strong, though. DeAndre Swift, 7K.
Chubb. Chubb.
Yeah. But he's 7'8", yeah. I'm DeAndre. The 8. Oh, okay. First of all, A.J. Dillon at 6,200 has to be the next talking point. I'm locking him in, too. So there's McCaffrey and A.J. Dillon locked in. James Conner, 6'1", is good. Sure, Chubb 7'8". Darrell Williams at 5'4", in that Chiefs game. If you're not going to play Mahomes, I think it makes sense to get exposure there. So Dillon and McCaffrey, my running back pool is going to be really, really narrow for GPPs.
I'm back on Michael Carter this week. I mean, the guy put up – in that ass-whooping that the Jets took, he put up 18.2.
Is DK Flacco going to –
Now, Flacco here's the question.
Flacco going to check down. Yeah,
that's the only question. This guy is just the focal point of the offense. He really is. So I do understand the risk with Flacco, no question.
But it could be a smash, though. Like, we don't know what he's going to do. That's the only thing. Like,
he just gets 20 touches a game, man. Sometimes, yeah, just sometimes more. He's just lock him in for it. The price of 5.8. It's a DK only. I don't like him on FanDuel as much. He's so much better on PPR.
Yeah.
So that's probably another guy that I'm looking down the list a little bit. Don't know what your thoughts are on him. Gosh, besides for that, maybe Jeff Wilson Jr. If Elijah Mitchell leaves, can I interest you in some Jeff Wilson Jr. 5.1K in that offense, and he'd probably be in line for a ton of touches.
Yeah, I think Jeff Wilson, Michael, I like Darrell Williams more than them personally, and I'm going to keep it narrow, but like I think they're good, very good low on pivots. And if you are going like a Mahomes, Tyreek, Kelce, where you don't need the Darrell Williams, I think you'd be fine going to one of those two. I don't think they'll make my build. Like, I like Gaskin. What are your thoughts on Gaskin, same game at 5.7K? He's been so, so bad, but the touches have been very, very good for the price.
Cash? I don't know.
Yeah, more cash than GPPs probably.
I don't know. Does he even really have much of a floor?
I mean,
maybe I'm just not on him.
He's literally went like 30 for like 64 yards. Like he has been so, so bad. Like, but I believe running backs don't matter. And if he's going to get the touches for the price, I don't know if that's right or wrong.
He's not going to be on my radar, but you know what? Just because of the volume and the matchup, I think that it's definitely something that we should look at. Rubio, any thoughts on Gaskin, Carter, any of these guys?
He was unlucky not to get in the box last game. I just felt like that they kept getting it to him on the goal line, and it was entirely, you know, his fault that he couldn't get in. But it's just like one of those things where, like, he get it easily pounced in the end zone twice. I faded him. I was very grateful that he didn't get in the box. But definitely a guy who could have easily had 25 or even 20, I guess, in this case. But I kind of like the call quite a bit here. The Dolphins are implied, like, 24, and that offense, you know, kind of is narrowed toward – like a Jalen Waddle or a Miles Gaskin or even a Gesicki. I know last week kind of felt like an outlier. But I think, like, if you're playing him, you got to know who you're kind of leveraging yourself against. Like, Darrell Williams is just – he just went absolutely berserk last game. Like, there's just no way around it. I think he had, like, 32 on the showdown slate, 48 in the captain slot. Just, like, unreal for PPR, unreal for just getting it done. And if the Chiefs are even going to – in any game script, it looked like they were leading the whole game last time out and he still got it done. He had over 100 yards receiving. 5-4 is just so soft. But if we even get David Montgomery back fully healthy, yes. Like, you know, like he's been getting the carries and, you know, we saw in the beginning of the season, like 5.5 is just another kind of soft price where it's like that guy has talent. That offense is not, you know, it's starting to get a little more comfortable. And he didn't look bad against the Steelers. And then he had the week bye. It can only benefit him quite a bit. So this mid-tier range is juicy. But, you know, A.J. Dillon's going to be – damn near locked for most people, and you have McCaffrey at the top, so it kind of leaves you kind of guessing on the third choice. But three running back week for me. I don't think I'm gonna go four wide receivers, but yeah, I really like this running back, you know, kind of mid-tier.
Deontay Foreman going up against what is that, Tennessee this week? What do you have, 13 touches last week? I just don't know how much they're even gonna score. So I don't want to mess with that. I feel like his name will be floated out there a little bit. And right when you were saying about talking about David Montgomery, I was just checking his game logs while you were saying it. 5-5 is just a joke. That's no. And 6-8 on FanDuel. Do you feel comfortable there? Because I like DK a lot more. I like that price.
DK over FanDuel.
Yeah. Okay. Wide receiver, boys. Rubio, why don't you take wide receiver first here? The top shelf guys. So Davante Adams, Tyreek Hill, Justin Jefferson, and I'm even going to throw Diggs and Debo in there, okay? The top three, Adams, Hill, Jefferson. Those are the 8K guys, and then you've got Diggs and Samuel right there.
Oh, man. Davante's he's on my shit list, but he's still the best wide receiver in football. This is in Minnesota too, so it's in a dome or whatever they call it. It might not be exactly a dome, but Minnesota's indoor stadium, beautiful weather, you know, because there is absolutely no weather. And 26 team total, we're already going to be on AJ Dillon. You could even do the capture stack, you know, I kind of didn't get mentioned, but Aaron Rodgers and Dak Prescott could definitely make builds, and you could do an Aaron Rodgers, AJ Dillon, and Davante Adams stack, and then run it back with the Justin Jefferson. Like, that's how much I like this game. It's a 50 total, I think it goes over. Title says, oh, this is one of the best Packers defenses that he's seen in a while. After the beginning of the season, he said it was one of the worst. So I don't know which one to believe, but I think this Packers defense is definitely not as stout as the previous weeks indicate. And I think this shows this week. And I'm a big fan of that game with Jefferson and Davante. You know, we're talking about the other studs, though. Debo Samuel, I just think the 49ers preferring to keep it on the ground. He obviously smashed with the touchdown, two touchdowns on the Monday night game, but I just think it's so risky to pay $7,800 for him. I think Jefferson and Adams are my 2-1, and Adams and Jefferson is my 1-2, but maybe Tyreek would squeak in as my third spot there.
at the top. What do you think here? You love Jefferson. You always love Adams. Title, top shelf wide receivers.
Well, first of all, the Rubio's comment on defense. You definitely are not wrong in what you said. I didn't know who the heck Devondre Campbell was, and now he's one of the best. He got defensive player of the month last month. Eric Stokes is way better than I expect. Like, they got guys that are now actually playing. Justin Jefferson, I play him every week, but like I told myself last week when I was watching the game, I'm not going to stack or game stack a Packers team anymore because I trust their defense and I know they're fine pounding the rock. I'm not playing Justin Jefferson this week on my main builds. It's something I don't do, but I love Devontae. I love Tyreek. Those two are going to anchor a lot of my lineups. I'm good going back to Diggs, but I like Jamar Chase at 7,200. So I guess I'm not going to play Jefferson. I'll go to the other young buck. I really like that price at 7,200. Las Vegas just got absolutely shredded. Michael Gallup at 4,200. Like, if people are going to go CD and chase that, not chasing, I think he's fine. But Gallup played a lot of snaps. 4,200 in the best game environment, I think that's a very good value down there. I think, I don't know, DK Metcalf at 6,800 just staring me back. Like, this, of course, would be the game he goes back off. Or Tyler Lockett at 6,000. I still like both those prices. I'm not stacking the team, but I could see me one-offing them. My favorites, though, Devontae, Tyreek, Jamar Chase, and Michael Gallup are the ones that really – or T. Higgins, too. What's 5,400 T. Higgins?
More targets than Chase in the games he's played.
I mean, only and by that's,
one, but still.
That's going to stay that way, I think, but Chase has the more – like the yards, yards per target is by far a Chase, so you get the home run upside. But cash games, full PPR, like – T. Higgins is always mispriced. 5,400 is still too cheap.
Rubio, let me just throw this at you. It's just sad to see Allen Robinson at 4.9K, and I'm not even going to ask you if you'd play him or not. It's just sad. Poor Allen Robinson. You know, first he had to deal with Blake Bortles and then the dog shit in Chicago, and now he's got a rookie quarterback. 4.9K. I mean, just pour one out for my boy Allen Robinson, man. It's a sad day.
He's good. He always plays in Chicago. No,
he's
so it's
great. Like, he's a great wide receiver.
Well, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of great wide receivers. That's what I mean. Like,
his quarterbacks suck.
Yeah. And he plays in Chicago where it's snowing and maybe bad weather.
Maybe Fields will get going here in a couple weeks. Rubio, please give me the rest of your wide receiver breakdown. I'm going to go get a popsicle, by the way. You guys okay with that?
Yeah, go get yourself a popsicle, Holton.
Thanks, guys.
You do so much for us. So.
Thanks.
Go get your popsicle.
Yeah.
T. Higgins, Jalen Waddle, 5,600 and 5,400. I think those two guys, you know, kind of stand out off the page, I guess I should say. You know, Jalen Waddle has been a target hog, and I think with Tua back under center, Tua tends to look for guys he's familiar with, and he's a little bit familiar with Waddle. And those targets have been just outrageous. I think he had 43 in the last four games before the Thursday night game last week. So, his targets are just outstanding. You know, you look at Higgins the same way, too. This Raiders matchup, we just saw Tyreek Hill get a brace. And then, you know, also looking down here, you got, like you said, Michael Gallup at 4,200. He was 4K last week, and he easily could have got there. I mean, I know the Cowboys put up a lot of points. Seven of those were from a blocked punt. But I'm a huge fan for Gallup. I almost played him last week, and it would have been better than my Russell Gage play. But he's definitely someone I'm looking at. You got Mecole Hardman in the same game at 4K. And Hardman's snaps have continually, you know, he's kind of taken over for DeMarcus Robinson completely. And DeMarcus
his snaps last week were Pringle took his snaps. He only got like 17 Hardman.
Really? Over week. Hardman?
Pringle like doubled him. He took it over his role.
Really?
And he scored.
And he scored.
Yeah, I ended up getting lucky then in that case because I did have a little bit of Pringle on the showdown slate. Just because I like Pringle a lot, his snaps were trending up, but I had not checked the.
It was like 17 to like 30 something.
Holy cow. Yeah, that is surprising right there. Mecole Hardman, 23 snaps. DeMarcus Robinson, 26. That Josh Gordon, 33.
Oh, maybe it was Gordon that I saw. But yeah.
Wow.
Hardman, I'd be
Pringle did get 46. So, I mean, or 30, 38 in this case. So,
it could be Hardman next week.
Yeah, Pringle and Gordon have.
I would be worried though. Like,
yes.
Guessing outside of Kelsey Tyreek there, I don't, and Darrell Williams, on a main slate is definitely a little risky.
You know the guy I love? I don't know if you brought him up, Rubio. Okay, Brian Edwards. So he's only a tournament play. And he's got to get back in the end zone. but he has in two of the last three games. And he's only 4.1K on DraftKings. I think the Raiders are going to trail. I'm looking for the Bengals to come out and lay the hammer down. And if they got to throw, he's going to get four or five targets and a shot in the end zone. So Brian Edwards would just be kind of a cheapie. I'll throw that out there at you.
As long as Eli Apple remains active for the Bengals and continues to start for them, I think you can definitely make the case.
You like him more.
Oh, Eli Apple sucks, man. God, mm-hmm. I'm even an Ohio State guy and Cincinnati fan. He's just awful. Good. He gets burnt. Mm-hmm. I think that's Dominic Peoples-Jones got the touchdown against him. So the big plays have been sprung against the Bengals, and he's part of the reason.
AJ Green has no upside. I'm not going to bother. Can we just talk about Robbie Anderson going forward? I know he burned everybody, but then he scored. And it's because Cam Newton is there now. Can we change our mind on Robbie Anderson? Or he's still dead to us.
Just play McCaffrey in that offense. Don't even risk doing any of that.
Rubio?
Yeah, nah.
It's a sad day, and we can't play him either. All right, tight end. Kelce said he's got his swag back.
Swagger back.
You know what that means, Title?
Got a swagger back.
Got his swag back. Kittle scored in back-to-back games for the first time in his career. Believe it or not, Waller's right there. So basically it's Kelce up top and then Kittle, Waller, Andrews. Give me the rundown at the top.
So you got to go Kelce. I like up at the top for sure. I don't know if I'll have the money though. I want to pay up at wide receiver, kind of want to pay up at running back. He's not a priority, but if I have the money, I like him. You have to choose between Kittle and Waller because they're in the same price range. I'm going to go with Waller. I think they're going to be trailing against Cincinnati. I think Cincinnati's secondary is bad. Waller's been so bad. His ownership's going to be down because of it. This could be an absolute explosion spot. I love Waller at 6'1". And then if you're not going to go Kelce or Waller, you just go down. Goddard, 4'4". I know he got banged up last game, but I expect him to be healthy. I think 4'4 is a really good price. Dan Arnold's wide receiver 1. We keep saying it on this podcast, but 4-1's a good price.
That's the play. He's getting consistent volume.
The other two, if you want to even save a little more, Cole Kmet at 3-4 or Gerald Everett at 3-1. That's as cheap as I would go, but tight end's good.
We don't want to go back to Conklin.
I'm personally not. I name like 5 or 6. I think you could, but like the 5 or 6 I named, I usually try and cap my tight end pool there, so. That's it.
Now, Rubio, tight end. Luke, can you start at the bottom then? Like, who interests you down low? Who's your favorite cheap guy? And by the way, let me give AP a shout out because he had Njoku left. He had a really good call at tight end. I don't remember who it was, but he had a great call. So shout out to you, AP. He probably doesn't listen either. Anyways, Rubio.
Yes, he doesn't.
No? This is like one of those weeks where God, the bottom tier of tight end is pretty bad until you get to about Cole Kmet, who looked really good there in the second half against the Steelers. And I think a bye week, every week that Justin Fields gets more comfortable, that can only benefit the offense. And I think Cole Kmet's going to be a big beneficiary of having a full extra week to prepare for the Ravens. I think even Allen Robinson in the same boat and stuff. I just think this Bears team can finally blossom into a decent offense as we've anticipated for the most part. They got a ton of talent, and Montgomery being healthy can only help that. And I think Cole Kmet, 3,400 is probably the cheapest I'll go this week. I like Dalton Schultz, 4,600 in a good game environment. I think that this Chiefs team will give a lot of respect to Cooper and CD Lamb, kind of even respect Gallup's, him as the third spot, a third wide receiver. And Dalton Schultz for, 4,600 has been a guy who's been a red zone threat for Dak and could go under the radar in a good game stack. Dan Arnold, 4.1, kind of still there. Kind of got there in the second half, was really kind of non-existent in the first half, but they are going to be trailing against San Francisco. My only fear is that game could get slowed down to a halt a little bit if the 49ers can start to gain momentum on the ground. I'm not really interested in spending up at tight end. As usually, like I would love to, but God, these guys are just tough to spend up on. Hockenson can always get the targets. Andrews, it's a tough matchup. I think Waller is okay. I definitely think the upside's there. He's definitely got the best upside, and the Cincinnati defense is not very good. I just think they struggle to defend the wide receivers a little bit more than the tight ends and even the running game. So I just think if Cincinnati's weak spot is not in covering the tight end. It's more covering the deep threat and avoided getting gashed by the run game.
That's Waller, though. I mean, he's a wide receiver at the end of the day, right?
Very much so, yeah.
What are you guys' favorite game? What is it Cowboys Chiefs title? What is your favorite game? Give me your top two games that you'll be targeting when you do play tournaments this week.
Yeah, I mean, I can't avoid that Cowboys Chiefs game. 55.5 is way more than the rest. But after that, it is this Bengals Raiders game. Like, I love Higgins. I love Jamar Chase. I love Waller. And you guys frozen? No, you guys can hear me. And both you guys did not move, and I was like, and then I like Renfro. So Waller, Renfro. The thing is, like, Joe Mixon, nobody's going to play him, and the Bengals are going to play, or people are going to play some Bengals wide receivers. Like, is he the best 3% own, like, leverage play if I love that game, now that I'm thinking about it? And I love running back, and he's not grading out well compared to the other guys around him. But, like, doesn't – I don't know. I'm talking myself into a 3% leverage off a Chase or a Higgins. What are your thoughts, Rubio or Holden?
He'll definitely be 3%.
No one's going to play him.
He's been 25-plus potential. Like, I just think he's losing a little bit of snaps to Samaje Perine. Just judging by the eye test, I haven't looked at any data at all. And as a Bengals fan, I feel like Samaje Perine's even kind of getting a little more snaps than usual. But I think you can easily look on the opposite side of that game. And a guy who has been Joe Mixon light is Josh Jacobs at 6K. I think that game could go either way. And I think either running back could absolutely explode. I really like Mixon a ton. He's been getting involved a lot more in the receiving game this year. 7,600 is a ton, but I honestly like him a lot 1%. More than
Chubb. I'm saying 1%. Yeah, I mean, Josh Jacobs would probably be the smart. Projection-wise, he would be. Like, man, have we not seen Joe Mixon? Last year in a Millie Maker, Joe Mixon was 3%, like week four or something. They won the Millie. Like, Joe Mixon has
He always scores. He scores every fucking game. Actually, let me look at this here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 straight games he scored a touchdown.
I have a ton in best ball. Him and Jonathan Taylor. I think this is just a spot where I play a two. I love that Bengals. Like, so to answer your question, yeah, the two favorite games, I'm going to eat some of the Dallas and Chiefs chalk. But you can go so many ways because you can go Gallup. You can go CeeDee. You can, like, the game's just the best. Someone's going to be low-owned. And then I love that Bengals-Raiders game in a dome too. Those are my two favorites.
How about you, Rubio?
Yeah, I won't say the Chiefs and Cowboys because I'm not. I am very basic, but I would say I'm going to kind of go the Green Bay Packers-Vikings game. I kind of touched on that earlier. I love Dylan. I love Justin Jefferson. I really like Davante Adams. I'm going to kind of go a game that I didn't get a big chance to discuss here, but Michael Pittman against the Bills. I think the Colts finally trail and aren't going to be dominating a game, and that actually leads to PPR stats for these Colts wide receivers, and Pittman's been just Carson Wentz's favorite target the entire time. So 6.1, I really think the Colts, if they're trailing this game, could absolutely go bonkers. And the Bills offense is hungry, and that's just the one way of putting it. I think they could easily get 35, 42, and this game could easily go over.
If you want to know a sneaky game that you guys are going to laugh at, but this is not a full game stack whatsoever, but San Francisco, Jacksonville, especially if Mitchell is out, I could see Wilson. I like playing James Robinson, and it doesn't matter what the matchup is. Debo Samuel is the superstar that no one plays because he's priced right around Jefferson, right? Jefferson, Hill, Adams, and then it's Debo. So people haven't been playing Debo, so there's somebody else that I like. And you have Dan Arnold and George Kittle. So I don't think it's like, oh, I'm going to throw – five guys from this game in there, but I might have two guys from this game, maybe even three guys from this game. And no one's going to play the Jaguars, right? No one wants to play that shit. No way.
No, that's a very low-end game. Yeah. I mean, you need some – like, now that I – because when we were talking – I think we should end every show on that question. I think that's a really good one. Now that I'm looking at – like, because I have 150 Yahoo, I have 150 – I might just play those two games. Maybe I'll throw the Bengals-Raiders and the Chiefs game. Maybe I'll throw Josh Allen and Cam Newton a part of it, but like I think I'm just going to fully 150, and then those are my only quarterbacks, and I'm just going to stack those games mainly, and then secondary stacks you mix in. But that might be a way that I'm going to start building, because once you start playing 9 quarterbacks and 10 quarterbacks, and you're spreading yourself so thin.
I've been saying that since we started this. The one thing I learned, just knock off a whole bunch of games off your schedule. Yeah. Just don't even bother with them. Rubio, do you do the same thing? Are you still a nine quarterback guy?
I've never been a nine quarterback guy. I think that's actually been one of my issues, is that I'll zone in too fast.
Too much?
On like two or three. Yeah. I need to expand my range a little bit. And I think talking to BigT and stuff, whenever I do MME, when I kind of get the small chance to lately, when I'm not working, is don't X out anyone. But in NFL, it's a little different. Make sure you get your stacks lined up, but let your projections do the talking. If you take your time out of your day to do your own projections, like, let the projections talk. Don't X out guys, or don't bump down guys, because you're like, oh, you know what? I don't think I'll do well. Because there's certain times, like tonight, I projected Rubio for like 28, and I really liked Rubio coming in for NBA. And if he's not fitting, he's not fitting. It's just like one of those things where I'm not going to bump him up. That's exactly where I'm firm at. And I don't X anyone out. I don't bump anyone overly too high unless I'm really high on them. And it's helped out a lot.
What do you use for your projections?
Well, a lot of self-judgment of opinions and stuff, but it's for soccer. It's all self-made. It's all kind of like projected in to where, you know, when you play DFS soccer long enough, you know exactly the positions and where they're projected for and everything. And that one's just off the dome. But for NBA, right now I'm kind of over on SaberSim, and I'll bump certain guys up before looking at a showdown slate. I'll make their projections the way I think they go, and then I'll build my showdown lineups. And if, let's say I think the most I'm doing right now is 20. I think I did 50 earlier in the week, but I'm just going to go back to 20 because I work today and fuck work. You know, I need to get out of that 9-to-5 business, or I guess that 9-to-9 business with Verizon, but it's definitely helped me out a lot.
Shots at corporate America. I love it.
It's not too bad. I love my bosses. So.
Title, want to bring that up to you. Like, do you have your own projections? What do you use? Are you a hand builder? You can't for an MME like that. You can't for a 150. So talk to me about that.
Yeah, I look at a bunch of different sites, aggregate some. Like, I don't make my own. I look at – and there's so many projection sites out there now in the industry that you look at. When you MME, yeah, whatever one I come to, if I aggregate it or, like, a certain sites or whatever, then I plug those in. But I personally, like, I X out. I run my script, like, my 150. I put stacking rules. I put certain things. But then when I run it, I get, like, 13 quarterbacks in my 150 on Yahoo. And then I usually scroll down. If like I only have three quarterbacks out of 150, I'll just X out that quarterback, and then it rebuilds. Because so I run them, I run my stacking thing, and then I make adjustments by Xing people out. Justin Jefferson pops up 6%. I'm like, no, I want 20% Justin Jefferson. So then in tournaments, you got to make your own in stands. Personally, that's how I do it. So I manually bump people up, manually bump people down, and cross people off after I run it.
I like it. That's a fun show, guys. Good work tonight, Rubio. Titletown. It's a lot of good conversation. RPS Heater 25% off your first payment of a monthly plan. Get the bet side too. If you just sign up with the regular price, you get a discount for. I mean, you don't get you get more than one. What is it? 1 month of it. You get the bet side as well. Get bets. So if you already got our sports side, then type in the code get bets and you can get bets. That's as simple as that. For Title and Rubio, I'm Holden. Thanks for listening to the NFL Spread Pod here on Run Pure Sports. Simon, get us out of here.